promises of God.
The old rugged cross, 141. Let's do the first, second, and the fourth verse.
I am bound for the promise. blessings that it has brought. And now we can honor you as we bring our tithes and offerings to you. May we be good stewards of that. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Society, balancing our responsibility to God and then our responsibility to the government can be very challenging, can it? But as believers, we have to always remember we have dual citizenship. Not only are we citizens here where we live, but we are citizens in heaven as well. And we're going to have a heavenly address when we get out of this life. And so, a spiritual address, as all of you do as well, that are Christians, if you're born again, of course. So since we are residents of two different places, we should learn how to live responsibly in both, shouldn't we? I think. Jesus said, occupy till I come. Do y'all remember that? That is, stay busy until I come. That's in John 17. He even prayed for his disciples, saying, my prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you keep them from the evil one. Interesting prayer, isn't it? Keep us from the evil one. Our Lord never intended that we live in caves or monasteries or as hermits, did he? He never intended that. We aren't to shirk our responsibility as citizens of America, isolating ourselves from everybody around us. In fact, Jesus even put it this way, behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. In the midst of wolves. Now, if I'm a brand new believer, a brand new sheep, that doesn't sound comforting, does it, to go out in the midst of wolves? But Jesus, he actually loves the lost folks so much that by sending us out into the middle of the woods, his prayer, his hope, and obviously he knows what's going to happen, but he knows some of those woods are going to become sheep, don't he? Some of them are going to become saved. That's his plan. So we have to balance our responsibility as believers to God with our service to our country, our state. That's Paul's focus here in these first seven verses. Let's read starting in verse 1. Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except from God, and the authorities that exist are appointed by God. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists the ordinance of God, and those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of the authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For he is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Therefore, you must be subject, not only because of wrath, but also for consciousness' sake. For because of this, you also pay taxes, for they are God's ministers attending continually to this very thing. Render therefore to all that are due, taxes to whom taxes are due, customs to whom customs, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Now before we unpack these verses, let me give you a little background of the time that Paul wrote this. What was the government like when Paul wrote this during Paul's time? Now there was only one government in most of the known world at that time, right? The Romans government. They basically controlled the whole known world back then, the Roman Empire. Now, Rome had been a republic, but during Christ's time and after that, it became a dictatorship under one man, Caesar. Caesar is a title. I mean, you had Caesar Augustus, you had all these different Caesars, but Caesar is like king. And he had unilateral authority. In other words, he could do anything he wanted. If he wanted to, he could take a census of the whole world and tax it. And that's what he did. The New Testament documents this. That's probably the first time that people were taxed like that. Also, every year, the citizens of Rome throughout the whole empire, they had to publicly swear allegiance, saying, Caesar is Lord. How would you like to do that? And they were given a certificate after they did that, that proved this. This certificate basically said, here's someone who has sworn allegiance. In other words, a good citizen. And you carry this around with you, this certificate. Caesar had a Roman Senate. He did have a Senate, but they were basically a rubber stamp for whatever he wanted to do. Power was really held by him and him alone. And we also know that Rome delegated some authority to their governors. Each territory had a governor. And Israel was a territory. And you know some of them, you've heard their names, like Pontius Pilate, like Felix in the book of Acts. But they also had deputies or proxies. And that's how Israel was allowed to have King Herod. Y'all remember King Herod? A king under Rome, but still a king. With so much power that he could order that every male child under the age of 2 be killed. Y'all remember that? be killed in a certain area, and he did that without any repercussions at all. Can you imagine that kind of authority? He couldn't be impeached. He couldn't be voted out. He couldn't be put in prison. What he said was carried out. It was the law. Now add another layer to this, slavery. There was a whole bunch of slaves back then. Slavery was actually an epidemic in the Roman Empire. It was documented that between one-third and one-half of the entire Roman population were slaves. Think about that, if one-half of America was slaves. Think about that. Add to that, this oppressive taxation that they lived under, that it took to keep that Roman government financed. Can you imagine? And you understand a little bit of the government structure when Jesus lived and when Paul wrote this, when Paul lived. And with that in mind, we get to this section in Romans 13. These are going to teach us five different things, five elements, I would say, that model our relationship to secular government, the Christian's relationship. So first is our role. This is verse 1. What should our role be to the government? It's summed up in one word, actually, subject. It says, let every soul, and I think that would include all of us that are living, since we all have souls, right? Let every soul be subject to the governing authorities. Maybe you don't agree with that. Maybe you're thinking, well, maybe it doesn't really mean what it says. Just in case you believe that, look at verse 5 real quick, because he says it again. Therefore, you must be subject. That's an imperative. Y'all know what imperative is? That's a command. That's not optional. What does that mean, subject? Peter took that same word and translated it to submit. Subject or submit, same word. The Greek word is actually hupotheos, and I'm going to butcher this, hupotasso, I don't know. Some of you have heard that word before, probably not, but anyway, it comes from two words, hupo, which means under, and tasso, which means line up. So line up under, think about that. Most of y'all were in the military. Y'all remember having formations back in the military where you had your commander out in front of you, and then when you were in the line, the highest ranking guy was over to your right and so on. That's basically how it was used in military sense. It meant an attitude of cooperation under your leadership. So the basic role of citizens, including Christians, is to help carry the burden of government by submitting to it. In a nutshell, believers aren't supposed to be subversive. They're not supposed to be rebels. They're not supposed to be troublemakers. They're supposed to be model citizens. Model citizens. Now, why did Paul think this was so important when he's writing this? Because at the time he wrote this, and it would get actually far worse from that point going forward, but at the time Paul wrote this, Christians were already being viewed very suspiciously by the government. Why is that? Because their conduct was so different than everybody else. And isn't that what we're supposed to do? We're supposed to be different. They had their own private meetings. I mean, that puts you up for suspicion right away. Private meetings, church, in people's homes a lot of times. They did not worship the Roman emperor as their god, did they? Or their lord. And so their actions were being scrutinized. They were being watched. So Paul thought it was important that they be seen as model citizens without compromising their faith. Key thing, compromising. Without compromising their faith. Something else you need to know about their government. Who was Caesar at the time when Paul wrote this? Do y'all remember? It was Nero. Nero, infamous. He would be the very Caesar who took Paul's head off. The same exact one that took Paul's head off. He will be the one responsible for Paul's death. Paul, yes, that very guy who writes this during Nero's reign, saying, let every soul be subject to governing authorities. Now we can approximately date the book of Romans to around 58, AD 58, which means 6 years later, AD 64, an event happens which some of you might remember if you've studied world history, the Great Fire of Rome. That happened in AD 64. A great A great fire broke out and it decimated the city. It didn't totally destroy it, but it decimated it. And a rumor started spreading that the fire was set by none other than Nero. Well, when that rumor started, what did Nero have to do? He had to find a scapegoat because he didn't want it being spread around that he caused the fire. So he had to blame it on somebody, and he blamed the Christians. That's what he did. He said, it's those Christians. They lit the fire. Those guys. And a rumor started spreading that the fire was set by the Christians, and it set in motion a series of persecutions that were unbelievable. Let me tell you what they did to Christians. He got the idea that he was this is Nero, a great chariot racer. I mean, he really wasn't, but he got the idea that he thought he was. And he loved it so much that he didn't just want to do it during the day. He decided he'll race the chariots at night. There's only one problem with that. They didn't have electricity. Thomas Edison hadn't yet invented the light bulb. So they had to find a way to light the track. He built this brand new track in Rome. And he had to find a way to light it. What did he do? It's horrible. He came up with this idea. He ordered Christians to be rounded up, and he had them impaled on poles, covered with pitch, and lit on fire to light his track at night. Can you imagine that? The persecution that these guys went through. So what do you do when the world you live in is filled with somebody like that? Nero, or maybe Adolf Hitler, or Stalin, or Putin, or whatever. What do you do? Hold that thought. We're going to get back to that in a minute. But that's our basic role towards government. Basic is be subject or submit. Let's look at the second element here. God's authority. Look at verse 1, second sentence. For there is no authority except from whom? It says God, don't it? The authorities that exist are appointed by God. Wow. Therefore, whoever resists the authority resists God, and those who resist will bring judgment on themselves. This is difficult, guys. This is a difficult statement. It's difficult for me today because I look around. I mean, look at our government. It seems to be very corrupt at times, don't it? We seem to have a two-tier judgment system. Depending on what your politics are is how you're handled by the authorities, I mean. But Paul begins where we ought to begin, with the sovereignty of God. What's his point? That power really has only one source, and that source is God. God is the source of all power. No matter how well or how horribly that power is used, all power comes from God. And if that's difficult for you, and it is for me sometimes, look at Jesus' example. Remember, Jesus had no problem with that. Jesus stood before Pontius Pilate, the very man who would allow his execution. And at one point, as Pilate questioned him, do you remember that Jesus remained silent? Y'all remember that? He had nothing at all to say to him. So Pilate said to Jesus, this is in John 19, are you not speaking to me? Do you not know that I have the power to crucify you and the power to release you? What did Jesus say to that? He said, you would have no power at all against me unless it had been given to you from above, didn't he? Did you hear that? Pilate, the only reason you have power is my Father in heaven put you in power. He allowed it. That's Jesus saying that to the guy who's going to send him to his death. Okay? I'll give you another example. Old Testament, Pharaoh. Remember Pharaoh? He butchered God's people, didn't he? Persecuted them, put them in slavery. But in Exodus chapter 9, verse 16, the Lord said, for this reason I have raised you up, that I might show my power in you. So who raised him up? God. God did it. It was God's decision, God's sovereignty. Human government, think about this, was established by God. It's part of what theologians call common grace. Have y'all ever heard that term, common grace? Common grace is the idea that people that are saved and unsaved, they all have air to breathe. We all have air to breathe, right? We all have this beautiful world. We all have water to drink. Whether we're saved or not, we all have common grace in certain areas. Doesn't mean we're saved, but it means we all have air to breathe. You know, the beauty of nature. Jesus said the sun shines on the just and the unjust alike. He also said the rain falls on the just and the unjust. That's common grace. That's the idea. Government is in that category. Part of the way government restrains evil in our fallen world is through laws, through the police, through the justice system, and even armies. And you can say, well, why armies? Well, because so much evil is irrational, and it can only be stopped by force. Think World War II, Hitler, you know. And you're not going to find a perfect form of government, though, of course. And certainly there is no such thing, at least that I know of, is a Christian government, at least today, a Christian nation, at least not that I know of. But we have our role with government. We have the role of government. We have the rule of government. We're supposed to be subject to that. Let me give you a third element, the reason for government. Why does it exist? What's the purpose? To protect and to punish. To protect and to punish. Look again at verse 3 through verse 5. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to evil. Do you want to be unafraid of authority? Do what is good, and you will have praise from the same. For he is God's minister to you for good. But if you do evil, be afraid, for he does not bear the sword in vain. For he is God's minister, an avenger, to execute wrath on him who practices evil. Therefore you must be subject, not only because of wrath, but also for consciousness' sake. So government exists to protect the community and to punish criminals. But did you notice the word Paul uses here for the government officials? Did you see minister? Minister? Think about that. We don't normally think of that, do we? Minister. When is the last time you got pulled over by a police officer, rolled down your window, and thought, there's a minister of God? You know, the word he uses for minister, by the way, is the same word we get deacon from. It means servant. What Paul means is that government officials on all levels are in a divinely appointed office. That's what Paul's saying here. This should maybe make us feel a little ashamed if we get angry at them, shouldn't it? Instead, we should thank them for their service. That should give us a very different attitude, really, concerning the police, shouldn't it? Thank them that they're in harm's way. This isn't easy to do when you're getting pulled over and getting a ticket, is it?
Nope.
Thank you, sir, for your service. But we should do it. So the purpose of the government is to protect and to punish. And the fourth element is a response to government. Now, we are already know we're subject to it, but he expounds on that in verses 6 and 7. Verse 6, for because of this, you also pay taxes, for they are God's ministers. Think of the IRS now as God's ministers. That sounds like a stretch, but here it is in the Bible. And if you're going to believe the Bible, do you pick out parts that you want to believe, or do you believe all of it, you know? Continuing in verse 6, attending continually to this very thing. Boy, that's an understatement, isn't it? That's all they think about is how they can take more of your money, don't they? But we're to submit to that authority. And then in verse 7 it says, render therefore to all their due, taxes to whom taxes are due, customs to whom customs, fear to whom fear, honor to whom honor. Number one, government should be supported. It has to be supported. They can't do everything they do without some money. That's why we pay taxes. But number two, government should be respected. Honor to whom honor. And guys, at the very least, we need to be very careful about how we speak about our government authorities and political figures. We might disagree with them, and I disagree with them a lot, but we are bound by Scripture to honor and pray for them. We're supposed to be praying for them. And if you talk about them, I hope most of your words are talking to God about them and not other people. When Paul wrote to Timothy in 1 Timothy, he said this. Now keep in mind, again, Nero is on the throne in Rome. He said, I urge then, first of all, that petitions, prayers, intercession, and thanksgiving be made for all people, for kings and all who are in authority, that we may live peaceful and quiet lives in all godliness and holiness. And then in other verses, he mentions taxes, even though some of our tax money may go to ungodly causes. And I know that. You can't say, well, I'm not going to pay taxes if they're going to use their taxes, if they're going to use my money for that. If you think the taxes are bad right now, I'm going to give you a little bit about their taxation back then. They had a system of taxation called tax farming. And I guess our government hadn't heard of this, or they would be doing it, or they hadn't studied it. But what that meant is you bid with the government for the job of tax collector. You paid money to become a tax collector in your area. The highest bidder got the job. Whoever paid the most for it was given the position. And Rome assessed each region. Let's take, for example, Arkansas. We're going to assess Arkansas for whatever amount of money. So the tax collector would go and collect that money, but anything in excess of that, he could keep. He could keep. You're talking about corruption. Can you imagine the amount of corruption with that? You could get twice as much as the assessed value if you could do it, if you could get it. And you could pocket all the rest. No wonder these guys bid for these jobs, right? Think about that. Guaranteed abuse, right? I mean, guaranteed. And what kind of taxes did they pay? Let me tell you. Every citizen paid what's called the poll tax. That's P-O-L-L. What does that mean? It's taxed because you're breathing air. If you're alive, you get taxed. Doesn't matter who you are. Just for living, you're taxed. Because you're taking up air. You're taking up space. What else? Every male age 14 to 65 paid that. Every female from 12 to 65 paid that tax. Just for being alive. On top of that, there's the income tax. That's flat 10%. 10%. On top of that, there's taxes for roads and harbors and other infrastructure. Then there's import taxes. Then there's the ground tax. That's like real property that we have today. Then they had crop taxes. One-tenth of all the crops, one-tenth was taxed. All the 10%, except for grapes and wine. They were taxed 20%, grapes and wine. Then there was the fish tax. The fish tax, you were taxed on your nets, how many fish you could catch. And then you were taxed on every fish you caught. Every one of them you were taxed on. On top of that, there was called the cart tax. If you had a wheelbarrow, you got taxed on one wheel. If you had a four-wheeler, you was taxed four times the amount. If you had a two-wheel cart, it was twice the. So if you could get by with a wheelbarrow, you was pretty good, you know. But if you had four wheels, pretty bad guy, you know. Now think about this. Into this world was born Jesus Christ, right? Jesus, the Messiah. And you can imagine what the Jews were hoping. If he's the Messiah, he's going to deliver us from this, right? He's going to deliver us from this oppression. They wanted him to go against the Romans to free them from that. But Jesus taught something different, didn't he? He didn't call for political insurrection. He never tried to overturn the tax code. He didn't really address slavery, did he? Was he aware of those things? Of course. Did it break his heart? Yes. He knew the great needs that were out there, but that's not why he came. He came for our spiritual needs, right? For a spiritual revolution. He knew if you could get a person saved, that saved person is going to change, isn't they? They're going to change. And if you want to change a country, get a person saved, get the family saved, get the community saved. That's how you change a country. And that's what he did. People were not happy with him because they wanted political deliverance. They wanted him to take sides. The Pharisees hated the Romans. They didn't want to pay any taxes. On the other hand, there was a group called the, and I'm probably going to butcher this, the Herodians. Herodians, I guess. They were Jews who believed in loyalty to the Roman government and that they should pay taxes. They believed you should pay taxes. And they never got along with the Pharisees until the day they did get along. Why did they get along? Because they both hated Jesus. That's why they decided to get along. They decided to try to trap Jesus. You remember them asking this question to Jesus? Master Jesus, is it lawful to pay taxes? Is it lawful to pay taxes to Caesar or not? Don't you love Jesus' answer? That's in Matthew 22. He said, give me a coin. He held it up, didn't he? He said, whose inscription is on the coin? It was Caesar's, right? He said, pay to Caesar's what is Caesar's, and give to God what it belongs to God, didn't he? Very wise, obviously. So God is honored when we're good citizens. He is honored. Not rebels, and not just because of the law, but for consciousness' sake. That's what Paul says, for a clear conscience. Speaking of clear conscience, you ever heard the story about the guy who had the guilty conscience? He wrote the IRS and wrote him a letter, and he said, dear sirs, I cannot sleep. Last year when I filed my income taxes, I deliberately understated my income. So I'm sending you a check for $150. But then at the end of the letter, he said, if I still can't sleep, I'll send you the rest. Anyway, that's good, right? Anyway, the point of Romans 13 is God is the ultimate authority. And these guys are in charge on all different levels. They're only there because God allows it. God appoints them, basically. I mean, he allows it. I don't know exactly how the process goes, but we're supposed to submit to the authorities. Now, this brings up this one issue, though, and I told you we'd get back to this. Is there ever a time for civil disobedience? Okay, and I'm glad you asked that. That brings us to our fifth element. I guess we could call this the counterpart against government. Notice a word in verse 5. It's talking about for consciousness' sake. The context is that we all have a conscience. And so by submitting to authority, we should generally have a clear conscience. But what about when we don't? When we submit to authority and our conscience is bothered? What about those times? What about when the government violates God's law and we see that? And our conscience is bothering us. The government's clearly violating the principles of God. Paul said, I always live to have a clear conscience before God and men. So what if the state passes laws or policies that oppose God? And let me make it even a little bit more complicated. Picture yourself. Put yourself in these shoes. You're living in 1850s America, 1850s, before the Civil War. You're in the South. You own a large plantation. And you have working on your plantation a number of slaves. Because you have no other way to get the labor for that. You have become a Christian, though, and you're starting to see a moral problem with this. This is wrong. Humans shouldn't be treated this way. And this is making you feel a bit uneasy. Yet, this keeps your economy going. It feeds my family. Without these guys, I couldn't get the farm taken care of. But then you read a newspaper in your area. The South is waging a war on the North and wanting to secede from the Union. What do? Do you stay in the South? Do you run across that line to the North, giving up your farm, your plantation, your livelihood? It's a moral dilemma, isn't it? What do you do with that? Let me give you another time in history. You're a politician in 1930s Germany. Everybody's so excited about this new guy, right? This new guy that's come along because you've just been in this inflationary environment. You guys think we have bad inflation. You know what it was like in the 1920s in Germany after the First World War? It got so bad that you had to have a wheelbarrow full of money to buy a loaf of bread. I've read the stories. I've seen the pictures. So you got this new guy come in, and the economy's finally recovering. And remember, in Germany, again, inflation had been so high. Now he's in charge, and the economy's really humming. And he gets a hold of you, because you're a politician, and he offers you a really high-ranking job in his administration. And you come to realize that he has an incredible bias toward the Jews. An incredible bias. And you realize that this could turn out really badly. What he says about them. What he says he's planning to do with them. But as a believer, you remember Romans 13. Be subject to governing authorities. And maybe you try to justify it by saying, well, look what Daniel had to deal with. and he succeeded. So what do you do? Is there ever a time, in other words, when believers' obligation to civil authority is negated by our identity in Christ? I would say yes, yes, and yes. And here's what I believe the Bible teaches. This is the principle. We submit to the government up to the point when obeying the government means disobeying God. Okay? When the government says don't do this and God says to do it, you have to make a choice, don't you? And the choice is to go with what God says. If the government says the opposite of what the Bible says, you have to obey God. Okay? That's the principle I believe that the Bible teaches. And there's a lot of biblical examples of this. Actually, tons of them. I'll spare you. I'll tell you a couple of them, okay? Number one, Pharaoh. We talked about him. He was in charge. He gave a law that ordered the Hebrew midwives to kill all the newborn baby boys who were Hebrews, didn't he? Well, guess what? They said no. They refused to obey. Exodus chapter 1. They feared God, it says. And they did not do as the king said, the Pharaoh said. That's civil disobedience. That aligns up with God's word. Another example, Nebuchadnezzar. Remember when he ordered Daniel and all the Jewish recruits to eat the delicacies from his table? And they said, no. You know, he was a kosher Jewish boy. He said, I'm not going to eat that. But you notice he did it with, he was kind to them. He didn't like blatantly say, he wasn't ugly about it. He tried to be respectful, is what I'm saying. But he said, I'm not going to defile myself. Civil disobedience, because it went against God. Third example, that same king commanded an image to be built, didn't he? A golden image, remember that? And there were three Hebrew workers on his staff, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. Y'all remember them? Uh-huh. And they said, no way. We're not going to do it. And the consequences was the burning furnace. Of course, they survived, didn't they? And that's a whole other story. But it was only because of God's intervention. And then we have Darius. He was the king of Babylon. And Darius made a decree that for 30 days, nobody could pray to God, any other God except himself. Do y'all remember that? You remember Daniel? He refused to do it. And they saw him doing it because he opened up his window. And he's not trying to hide his faith, is he? And he, guess what? He got him thrown in the lion's den, which was supposed to kill him, but he survived. Again, because God saved him. And then there's the Jewish Sanhedrin in Jerusalem when they passed a law that you could not speak the name of Jesus publicly. Peter and John found out and said, heck with that. And they went out and preached the gospel, didn't they? They got arrested. The authorities said, why are you doing this? You're not supposed to do this. We gave an order. We gave a command. It's the law. And I love their answer. In Acts chapter 5, we must obey God rather than men. This is civil disobedience that lines up with God, okay? Because to obey man would to disobey God. And they said, we'd rather face your consequences than face God's consequences. Amen?
Amen.
There's multiple other examples. We could look at Dietrich Bonhoeffer, who violated laws that Nazi Germany passed. He was killed for it. And then we're confronted with all kinds of issues today in our society. You know, laws on same-sex marriage, laws on abortion. We're confronted with a society that says, this is okay, that is okay. And we go, no, it's not. It's against God's word. And here's the rule, and I'll close with this. A Christian is to be a good citizen until being a good citizen means being a bad Christian, bottom line. Okay? That's the rule that you should apply. In closing, we could talk probably all day about our relationship with government and what about this and what about that situation and so on. But there's a bigger issue. We're talking about what should I render to Caesar, but what about what should I render to God? What should I render to God? You know, Jesus said, render to Caesar what belongs to Caesar, but what else did he say? Again, we've already said it. Render to God what belongs to God. So you have the image of God stamped on you if you're a believer. Okay? God wants you to surrender everything to Him, your life, everything, okay? That's what God wants. That's where we begin. Have you done that? Have you done that? We're going to do a song of invitation. Let's pray. Father God, thank you, Father, for this message today, for your words here, Father. And I just ask that you open our hearts and our minds, Father, to where we can see how we need to apply this to our lives. And help us to be godly citizens, Father, as good as we can be, without sacrificing your laws, Father. And Father, if there's anybody here that doesn't know you today, we just ask that today they would realize this is the day that they need to submit, Father, and they need to ask you to come into their lives and forgive their sins and become a Christian, Father, because this might be the only chance they have. I just ask that your Spirit work amongst our congregation, Father. And if there's anything we need to give up for your sake, Father, show us that as well. These things I ask in Christ's name. Amen. Amen.
Okay. Tenderly, 3:12.
Please stand and stand too as we sing this.